Hey guys, welcome to the beginning of the end. It is the 24th of October today. Cast change for the Book of Mormon is on the 26th. Now, I would have been on my way to Southampton, and I am indeed staying in Southampton tonight. However, there's been a new development in my plan, okay? And something I perhaps didn't expect to happen, and maybe it might explain why I am dressed as Marty McFly right now. I'm literally just sat in my hometown. I'm going out today for my weekend away, and I just got freaking Back to the Future Rush tickets for tonight at 20 past 10 as well. What the fuck? Oh my god. Oh my god. I got Rush tickets for Back to the Future today at 7:30 at the Adelphi Theatre. I have never got Rush tickets before, no joke. Got these at 10:30. And I got C22 of the stores. Now, if you don't know the layout of the Adelphi...
This train is for London Waterloo.
Now, if you don't know the layout of the Adelphi Theatre, let me break it down for you and show you a picture. I was essentially given row 3 in the very centre in the stalls. And from my research, Rush is genuinely pretty dry for Back to the Future. So, my boredom of just scrolling through the Today Tix app changed my entire day. I was going to go to the cinema in Southampton tonight. I might go tomorrow because my train to Woking. I know, I'm going all over the place. Tomorrow night I'm seeing Stevie Webb in He Come Again in Woking. But I'll probably go to the cinema tomorrow morning if I really want to. But I'm seeing Back to the Future tonight, so I immediately had to put Marty on. I mean, obviously you literally cannot do a Back to the Future trip, especially during Back to the Future week. Back to the Future day was on Monday the 21st, where I went to see Back to the Future Part 2 in cinemas, and it was really, really cool. But I'm dressed as Marty, and I'm ready to do my first Rush trip, my first theatre Rush trip. And the great thing about Southampton, and the fact that I am staying in Southampton, is the fact that I can actually get home to my hotel after the evening show. Where I live, in the middle of butt-fucking nowhere, I can't do that. So this is a luxury, and I'm going to take advantage of it.
So with that, I'll think I'll catch up to you when I'm in London. Which is crazy to say, I wasn't supposed to be going to London today. Holy shit. This is so cool. I'm seeing Back to the Future, not to mention there's a new cast. I should stop talking. Okay, I'll see you when I get there.
So you missed out the boring stuff where I went to Southampton for about an hour to drop off my bags. Who needs it? I was in London now. Weird to say, I was in Charing Cross. I briefly saw Lisa, who was going to see the Book of Mormon, and then I was suddenly at the Adelphi, which I didn't expect going out, going to the gym this morning. Like, this was crazy. And I was blessed by my Rush seats, guys. I got C22. Now, I already said this. This Rush ticket is insane. I'm not saying they never give you good seats. I'm just saying sometimes you get a shit seat. But this was like, holy shit. I think it might be a little bit better than front row. And that's saying a lot for me.
So it's like crazy that I'm here right now. I can't believe it, but I'm here and I'm at Back to the Future, and I got like the best Rush ticket seat ever for Back to the Future Day. That was on Monday the 21st of October. They have limited edition pins. So the DeLorean pin is their usual pin that they just sell. Then their limited edition one is the Marty McFly and Pinhead sign, which is just like, it's absolutely amazing. There's the DeLorean and there's the limited edition one. So, so cool. I love a pin. You know that about me. But it's great. We got the new cast on. We've got Vasco as Marty McFly. Corey English is playing the Doctor, which is always nice. The Doctor. The Doc. Dr. Emma L. Brown. Why did I say the Doctor like this is Doctor Who? Sarah Goggin is Lorraine, and we've got a new George McFly and Biff Tannen, so I'm really excited to see those guys. So, we're also kind of getting a surprise review in this vlog, because I'm going to have to talk about these guys, because I am thrilled, and I have been told many great things, so I'm so, so excited. But right now, I'm going to go enjoy Act 1. Didn't think I would be saying that today, but I'm going to go enjoy Act 1, and I'll catch you in the interval.
It's the interval, and I'm loving the new cast. They are incredible, and I'm still like in disbelief that I'm here. Like, I got these this morning and it's like, where the fuck am I, you know what I mean? But it is great as always. I love Corey and Vasco's dynamic. I think they work amazingly together.
And I'm just really excited because this is also Vasco's first West End role, which is also like just really cool. It's really cool to see someone's West End debut, even though it's not his debut. I mean, he pretty much just joined. They literally just switched the cast over. But I'm really excited for him, and I really, really want to see him grow in the role. I say this about a lot of people, like Book of Mormon, like the cast is changing in literally 2 days. And I'm going to be there. Like, I'm going to be there, absolutely, to support them. But I cannot wait to just see him more in this role, because he is incredible. I'm going to head back inside, because A, I'm cold, and B, the show's about to start. So I will see you afterwards. Made me pull my eyes out. Just today has been so spontaneous and special, and I just love it. I just absolutely love it. Oh my god. I cannot believe any of this is real right now. So I think the next time you see me, I'll be waking up in Southampton. This was a crazy night.
12 seconds later.
Hi guys, I'm up and it's the morning. I'm in Southampton. Good morning to you folks. Last night was absolutely crazy and it still doesn't feel like it really happened. But tonight I'm seeing Stevie Webb in Woking in Here You Come Again, the musical, and I've been excited for this, oh my god, for so long. But I'm even more excited to know now that they are coming to London after their tour. That's fantastic news. I'm wearing my Halloween shirt today, courtesy of Kevin and the character that Stevie plays in Here You Come Again. I know vaguely what the plot is, but I'm really excited to actually see it, you know? So that's what I'm doing today. I'm not really doing anything vlog camera worthy in Southampton, so I'm probably going to cut to me, and unless I do something interesting, I'm probably going to cut to me on my way to Woking to catch Stevie, and I'm so excited about this.
I'll see you then.
Hello everyone, so as you've seen, I made it to working just fine. I've had a couple hours to chill and also make a few things, and I have a few things that I made at home that I also want to show you now. So first off, like I did with the Mormon cast, I have made two bracelets today, one for Stevie, one for Trisha. So I got one that says Dolly, one that says Kevin. They are very, very cute, and I cannot wait to give them to them. And also, just like seeing Stevie again, I haven't seen this man in over a year. Like, that is... It's crazy. It's crazy is what it is. So that's going to be really exciting. Just quick though, before I pack up and leave, I also have another thing for Stevie, which is a piece of artwork. So I am no stranger to giving Stevie artwork. I gave him the painting of Henry. I gave him a drawing of McKinley. I gave him another drawing of McKinley. What else is there? A drawing of Kevin. So I've drawn this for Stevie. It is obviously him as Kevin, and here you come again. I took some liberties with the costume design, but I think it looks really cute, and I think he's going to absolutely love it and appreciate it. And obviously, I love supporting these guys. Like, they are incredible. Just like another quick thing, you may have noticed, you may have not, I got a new tattoo, and it is my biggest one yet, and it was a fucking pain. But I love it. So here it is in all of its glory. It's very traditional style. You've got the rose there, and then I've got some drama masks on the side. But yes, I'm going to head over to the New Victoria Theatre here in Woking, where I'll see Stevie, and here you come again. And I'm so excited for this show, especially because this isn't the end for it. It's going to London. That's so cool.
So a bit like the Barbican Theatre in London where Kiss Me Kate was playing, the New Victoria Theatre is in a centre of sorts. I don't know how I feel about these theatres. I like the classics, but my seat was great, the stalls are well elevated, and I absolutely loved my view.
I can promise to you guys that I will say more in the interval, but I just walked past Stevie Webb's dressing room. I walked past his dressing room door. I'll explain more later. Okay, bye.
Now, anxiety and my personal struggle with anxiety is nothing that I really talk about on this channel enough, really. I had a really hard time when I was coming here, and I'm sorry it's taken me this long to really get back to you. I had a hard time when I came here, obviously. I really wanted to see Stevie because I haven't seen him in a year, and I'm just like so proud of him at the minute. And I was trying to find a stage door, I couldn't find it, and I started like genuinely having a panic attack. This lovely, like lovely front of house man took me to the stage door himself, like walked me around, and then quite literally took me a shortcut backstage, back to the stalls, and I walked past Stevie's dressing room, and I still don't really know how or why that happened, but yeah, I mean, I had a moment, but you know, I've enjoyed Act 1 and I'm absolutely loving it. I'm going to go up into the foyer area to talk a bit more to you about how cool this show is, but just so you know, I had a moment and everything's fine. Actually, it's more than fine. That was really cool. But yes, I will catch you quite literally just up those stairs in a sec.
First thing I will say about Stevie, right now I am so proud of him. Like, I have never been prouder of anyone maybe in my entire life. You know, he did 10 years in the Mormon as pretty much a supporting role, you know? And now he's in a very like physically demanding role where he never leaves the stage. And I don't know what it is, it just feels like I'm watching Stevie. I just feel like he's totally in his element. Trisha is incredible. There she is, she's kind of hiding behind me. But everyone, like, oh my goodness, like, it's so good. And it's so real. It's very real, it's very raw, it's very, very good. And it does a great job at conveying the message that it tries to convey. You know, Kevin's this run-down guy who's kind of down his luck. And Dolly's sort of the only positive thing in his life. But obviously, she's not real when he's speaking to her. She's in his head, but that is essentially him speaking to himself about what he needs to do to love himself. And it's very, very endearing. That's what I'm going to say. It's endearing and it's real. And it has made me roll my eyes out so far. But Stevie...
enough with the emotional stuff. Stevie, I love you. If you're watching this, I don't think you are. Maybe, but I'm gonna catch some sleep and I'll see you tomorrow morning for the Book of Mormon cast change where there will be more tears. Yay!
Morning everyone, it's October 26th today, you know what that means. It means it's the day, finally, of the Book of Mormon cast change and I am very upset, but it's gonna be a great day. I'm going to both shows today, I'm meeting up with a couple friends. I'm getting into London about 10 o'clock, so we'll see what kind of adventures I get up to, but I am very excited to spend the day at one of my favourite shows and see off the 2020 whole cast, which is insane. Extremely excited to welcome the new cast also. That is something in this video that I will finally talk about because I haven't talked about casting yet. The one thing I will say that I am very, 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 very excited about is obviously Richard is leaving the role of Mephala. Ian Carlyle from Moulin Rouge, who I absolutely love, is taking his place. And that is amazing. Like, I love that. And I cannot wait to see Ian in that role. But for now, let's focus on the 2020 forecast because I love these guys and I cannot wait to see them off. I have a few things for them, but I think I'll show you those on the train. So without further ado, let's head on to the train. Well, for me it's about an hour and a half away, but for you guys it's gonna happen instantly.
Hello, I am on my train to London now. I've got up, I'm a bit more awake than I was in the last clip. I just wanted to show you a couple of things that I have got for the Mormon cast that are leaving. Namely, Ben and Edward. Ben covers Elder Price, and I saw his last Price show quite a while ago, so it's a bit emotional. And then, obviously, Edward plays the General, and I'm really sad to see him go, because I only just kind of started really getting to know him, but obviously, you know, I've always supported him, I've always supported all of them. So I'm excited to show you what I got. So this is the drawing that I've drawn for Edward. It's obviously the scene in I Believe when Elder Price breaks into his camp. I really love what I did here and I think Edward's gonna love it. Obviously, as always, I've got two copies. He can sign one and keep the other. It's just a nice thing because it dawned on me, you know, I've never drawn him before. I've given him the bracelet, but I've never drawn him until now. So I'm really excited to give this to him. Now, obviously, as I said, Ben covers Elder Price. So who better to draw him as than Elder Price? So this is what I drew for Ben. It's the infamous coffee scene, which houses one of my favorite monologues in the entire show, followed by one of my favorite songs in the entire show, Orlando. Which, fun fact, Angel went to see Book of Mormon in Orlando, like the US tour, last night. That is so cool. And I know they had the best time. Like, oh my god, I'm sending all my love to you. I got Tab this pretty neat necklace. Obviously, he's already got an art, he's already got a bracelet. I didn't know what else to get him, so I just got him a little trinket. Something that is very much his vibe, I think. I got this from a little seaside shop where I live. So it's very special to me because it comes from where I'm from. So I thought it was just a really nice thing to gift him. I promise I haven't forgotten about Jack McNeil. That's a surprise player, okay? And also, I know he's not leaving, but Joseph Davenport is one of my favourite people in this entire show. He is lovely, he is so, 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 so sweet. So I wanted to make him a little bracelet. So I made him a bracelet and it says Elder Swing on it because he is a swing. So I'm really excited to give him this. And hopefully sometime down the road, I will give him a piece of artwork as well. But I'll show you the bracelet. There we go, so it says Elder Swing. I did some green, orange, silver, just some colours that I thought fit his vibe. But yes, I'm really excited to give this stuff out. And I'm already so emotional about saying goodbye to this cast because I've known them from the beginning, pretty much. I'm just really happy that none of the main cast are going because I feel like that would break me. But I'm going to enjoy my train ride. I'm getting to London at about 10 o'clock, so I have no clue what I'm going to do for 2 hours. I might see if Lisa's around, if Danielle's around, anyone that I can hang out with. Because we got quite a fan club coming tonight, so we'll see what happens. I'm here. I just saw Ben Tyler in Brett, and I just looked directly up at him and went, oh
shit! But I'm here, and there's JJ. Now I'm just waiting for my buddies to join me. And then I might... I might wait till the evening, though. I might show you. You got a little sneak peek, a little idea. But I might show you what I got Jackman nailed. Ben's seen it. It's fantastic. My friends are having fun downstairs and I have to come all the way upstairs.
So for this afternoon's performance of the Book of Mormon, I was in front row, but a different way. I was in A14 of the circle. Now this is sold as restricted because of that pesky little thing there. I think that for 45 quid, this is really good.
So as I just said, I'm upstairs. I've caught my breath after climbing said stairs. This building is a nightmare, but I love it up here. And I'm front of the dress circle in the so-called restricted seat. It's literally not that restricted, as you have seen. Paid about 45 for it, so honestly, I am not complaining at all. So I just did a little art trade with my friend. I gave her some of my old 2022, 2023 cast prints. I gave her Dom, Gavin, and Jack. And also, she gave me some bits. As I said, it was like a little art trade, so she's given me some stickers of the current cast, these guys that we're about to see. So I'll show them to you later when I have someone else who can record me, or if I'm in my hotel room, but you will see them, because she is so talented, she's lovely. But I think we've got a full cast, and I am wondering if they're going to do a muck-up matinee like they did last year. I'll update you on that in the interval, because I genuinely have no clue, but it's gonna be an emotional day and we'll get through it together. All right, I'll see you in the interval.
Have you been wondering what is it with the shirt that I'm not telling you about? I mean, you kind of got a sneak peek earlier and I was like, what have I got Jack Neal? It's a shirt with his face on. You satisfied? He's got one, my friend's got one. It's a whole thing. Also, muck-up matinees, let's talk about those. I'm a little disappointed. There's a few things that I've noticed, but it's not as good as last year. I feel like this cast isn't having as much fun, which is okay. There was an extra sister at the airport. Joseph put on a nice little wig and a little pink outfit. Blair had so much blood on his face. Oh my goodness. And Dion's character, Andy Bailey, hanging out with her backside, which is a choice. It's a choice. But yes, I'm having so much fun. I'm not crying yet. That will be tonight, probably. A friend who's actually sitting upstairs. Everyone else is downstairs. Lucky them. But human tripod. And a good friend. You're not just a human tripod. Yes. But we're having fun. Very much so. I'll see you afterwards. I want to quickly bring your attention to the fact that I spelt his fucking name wrong. It's Neil with two L's. That's an L on my part, I guess. Hey!
Wowzers! Look at that!
The second L, I'm so sorry!
You get a blue marker. Thank you so much, you're so kind.
I was wondering if you could add it.
Add the L?
Yes.
Alright.
Do you want to sign it?
There you go. Just here?
Anywhere.
There you go.
I've got something for you.
And I've got a matching one, do I?
Yes.
Wow! Look at that! Amazing! Thank you so much! Bloody hell, look at that! That's a nice photo, isn't it? That middle one.
Yeah, I know, that was from Rick
Ray. Yeah.
That's just, I'm so sorry about that.
Oh, that's off that TikTok, isn't it? I'll kill Jed. Oh, thank you so much.
After that rather charming interaction with Mr. Jack McNeil that left me very overstimulated, I headed over, one stop on the tube, I'm lazy, I know, to Tottenham Court Road to see my underground hotel for the first time. Holy shit, I splurged on this, by the way, like, this is not cheap, but I was treating myself because I knew I would be crying in this bed by the time the evening was done. And I was, so I think it's worth the money.
This hotel room is so, so cool. And I mean that two ways, actually. It's cool and it's cool. There is so much aircon down here and it is wonderful. I've chilled for a little bit. I had to do a bit of a costume change because I ripped a hole in my jeans. Not great. As you saw, Jack not only added the L to the shirt, but he also signed my shirt. It was wonderful to see him. I was almost in tears. Speaking of tears, there's definitely going to be some tonight. Whether or not I document them, who knows. But right now I've got to make a dash. I'm going to grab some food really, 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 really quickly. And then I'm meeting Danielle for the matinee. The evening show. Oh gosh, I don't want it to be over, that's what it is. I'm meeting up with Danielle for the evening show because she sat next to me, so you get to say hi to her. Oh my goodness, it's a big night. I've already given out most of my presents. I've given out Ed's and Ben's. The only one I haven't is Joseph's, which is still on my wrist. Elmer Swing, we love it. We love that he was an extra price sister. That was such a funny moment. But yes, I'm gonna head back over to the Prince of Wales and cry.
Legend has it, I'm very overstimulated right now. What do you think?
Very.
I am like, I feel like I'm on crack or something, so hopefully the cider that I bought will like, actually no, that's gonna make it worse, isn't it?
Yeah.
Tears will be shed. I'll catch you in the interval. I'll probably go somewhere else, quieter, so I can like breathe and not annoy anyone. But I am like very, very, very hyperactive right now. So I'm just gonna shut the fuck up and show you where I'm sitting, which is A17, not A15. I got the wrong seat at first. Oops. So I'll show you that and then I will catch you in the interval. Interval and I'm a slightly more put together person. I feel like I can talk to you properly. It's been a lot, like this day has been a lot. You guys know that I am having the best time. It is so, so emotional with the fact that so many people are leaving us tonight. I'm trying not to cry right now because I'm gonna save that for later. Hopefully, I don't think it's gonna happen, but I'm having a great time and I'm speaking to you now with a bit more coherency, less overstimulation. Today's been absolutely amazing. I just wish I could travel back in time like Marty and do it all again because it's just wonderful. Actually, to be fair, I wish I could do this whole trip all over again. I've only got one day tomorrow and I'm seeing a surprise show that you guys don't know about yet, but I'll tell you more about that tomorrow. But for now, I'm gonna sit down, I'm gonna enjoy Act 2 and see who I can get on the vlog later. I don't know.
Hello, hello video blog, hello.
I've got the man, the myth, the legend.
That's me.
Love this guy.
Hey, I tried.
Love him. Oh, I wanna see you in whatever you do next.
Perfect.
You.
Well, you'll have to buy a ticket.
Well, yeah. Can you not give it to
me? No way.
Fan discount?
Good morning, everyone. Now, you may have gathered that last night was insane. It was mental and I bawled my eyes out. So I'm opening my granola. I went on a little adventure to get breakfast. I literally got on a train to get breakfast to bring back to my hotel because I didn't feel like walking 5 minutes down the road. What is wrong with me? Anyway, maybe it's just because I like trains. It's a bit of an autistic thing, I know. But last night was mental. You may have noticed that, where the fuck can I put this? It's covered in yogurt. You may have noticed, last night was fucking insane, okay? It was mental. Yesterday afternoon was mental. Like, the whole thing was mental. Credit to Danielle for that curtain call and speech video, by the way. Absolutely love her. That's a legendary move right there. But I was bawling my eyes out, so I'm kind of glad I wasn't sat next to her for the second half. We all swapped seats. It was a whole thing. Basically, I'm still feeling the effects of it, of the fact that I will never see that specific cast of characters again, and it's a hard thing to process in your mind, and Jack doesn't even know what he's doing next, so I'm in a bit of a predicament and like a limbo where I just have to kind of wait and see. But I was bawling my eyes out. I love all of them so, 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 so much. And it's just, it's the end of an era, and that's just kind of how it's got to be, you know?
Later on in this video, I will talk about casting, that sort of thing, for the new people that are coming into the show. I already mentioned Ian just because I am so excited to see that man play Mufala. But yes, it was a very emotional night. Ben enjoyed his art, Edward enjoyed his art. I didn't get videos or anything with them, but I got a few pictures, which I will show you later in the video because I'm going to do a whole sort of stage door merchandise review sort of haul part when I'm home. So I will do that when I do get home. In slightly exciting other news, I mentioned last night that I am seeing a show today and I didn't tell you which show it was, and I know you're thinking, oh, you're gonna go see Back to the Future again, they have Sunday shows. No. In something else, that the original thing it's based on is set in the 80s. I'm going back to Stranger Things. I almost said the musical one is wrong with me. I've said in the past that I get so mad when people say Stranger Things the musical, but I'm seeing Stranger Things the First Shadow today and I'm so excited to be back. They're changing their cast pretty soon, so I think it's my last time with the current cast before they switch, so that's gonna be really exciting. I should really hurry up and eat my breakfast because checkout's at 10 and it's just gone 9 o'clock, so I'll see you on the road. Right, I am currently on the hunt for someone who could agree with my logic here. So I had a seat for Stranger Things this afternoon that I paid for, £30 for the ticket, and it's right up in the gods. And I thought, they do £25 rush tickets, so if I get a good rush ticket, I technically only paid £55 for the seat. Am I right? I just got rush tickets for Stranger Things in the stalls E24, and I technically only gave them 55 quid. Yes, no one will be sat in the seat that I booked before. However, that doesn't matter. This is how my brain works. This is how I think.
So, surprise, surprise, and this was actually a huge surprise for me at the time, Ricarda also got rush tickets to Stranger Things via my influence, which I think is a good sign for today, let me tell you. She had actually never been to the show before, but she was familiar with the TV show, so I was like, yes, it's gonna work out. We went to Borough Market, where I was gonna go anyway, so we had a look around. Let me tell you, it's much more fun with someone else, I'll say that much, but we got a few spritzers. I dropped mine and then had to buy another one, which I totally did. Then I got the best mac and cheese I have ever had in my life. This shit had potato, it had bacon, it had white truffle, which was extra, but it was worth it. Like, oh my god, this was so good. And we also had this, like, coconut tea, like coconut oolong tea from T2U, I think it's T2U or T4U. I've been there before, you know the drill.
And then it was off to the Phoenix Theatre, where I had to show Ricarda the Scoops Ahoy bar. It's awesome, but we were so excited.
Hi guys, so as you know, Ricarda's joining me today because you also got rush tickets. And so did I. I'm so much shorter than you. I'm like, hello. No, it's all right. I am really excited. She's never seen it before.
First time.
Whoa. It's so cool to like introduce a show to someone, I think, because I've seen it 3 times now and this is my 4th, and oh my gosh, I'm so excited. I haven't seen the cast list yet, but I'm hoping we've got everyone on just because this is probably the last time I'm seeing them before it changes. I don't know who's leaving though, so we'll figure that out, but we're going to enjoy and I'll probably catch you later with her in the interval.
Definitely. I'm excited.
Yeah, see you guys. Cast update, we've got everyone, and we've also got Danny Sykes, one of my favourite people in the show, and he's a swing, and he's on today as Walter Henderson, so that is a very, very positive thing. One thing I will say is Walter sucks, like his character sucks, he's awful, but Danny's cute, so I'll let it slide. Is that allowed? Like liking someone who's like low-key abusive? No? It is a question. It's a fair question, though. Like, Elder Price is low-key verbally abusive to Cunningham. But we still love Elder Price. I'm really pleased that you're seeing this cast. Very, very pleased.
I'm really excited. Everyone's been telling me that I have to see it, and especially because there's a cast change soon, that I should see the original cast.
Yeah. And we've got the original cast, minus one. I think that's good.
Very exciting.
Yeah. Let's go enjoy Act 1.
Woo!
I don't know how I did this a second time in the same week, but I hit the jackpot with rush tickets again. This seat was so cool.
Obviously you've just seen my seat here. Ricardo's just behind me because obviously she got rush tickets as well. This for a rush seat is amazing. I've hit the jackpot with a rush this week, like wow. But this is also the first time I've sat on this side of the auditorium, so it should be interesting. But for real though, this time I will catch you guys in the interval.
My hand is literally shaking. Can you see? I mean, how are you finding it?
It's amazing. Like, it's gone by so quickly and I'm so like enamored and like just holding on to every second. It's so captivating. They're so talented. It's crazy.
Everyone is incredible.
Oh my god. I think both of us are like very overstimulated right now.
Yeah, like just got out of the interval and it was just,
It doesn't feel like an hour and a half.
It does not.
Do you know what I mean? Like,
it could have been like half an hour.
I have to steady my phone, my camera's shaking. Danny's a heartthrob, but he's a swing and he's playing an arsehole today. But just so you know, I still love him. We love the swings.
We love swings.
Danny is, and I know I haven't seen the show as many times, Danny is my Joseph Davenport. We have to stop this. Guys, I'm finally getting onto it. I'm finally filming the final part to this longer than expected cast change video. Like, as I'm recording this right now, it is already 40 minutes long. I don't know how I did that, but anyway, yes, I am here to talk about the shows that I saw. Mainly, Here You Come Again, the new Back to the Future cast, and first, I think we should go in chronological order and speak about Here You Come Again first. So the plot of Here You Come Again. Kevin, our main character, played by the wonderful Stevie Webb, is in lockdown. He's living at his parents' house, in their attic, more specifically, and he does a cracking Yorkshire accent for this role, let me tell you. And having this show set during the COVID pandemic, obviously it does mean it was written recently, but it also means that it's relatable. Like, it's very, very, very relatable to the audience watching it. So a bit more about Kevin personally as a character. He's a bit down on his luck. He's a failed comedian living with his parents, you know. He just had a massive breakup with his boyfriend. Things aren't going great for him, but he has Dolly Parton. And in that respect, I mean that she is his idol. He has posters of her everywhere, absolutely everywhere. Now, obviously, these posters are ones that Trisha made because Trisha is playing Dolly Parton, but he has a bunch of Dolly Parton memorabilia all over his place. And Stevie even said, I will insert a picture of the stage here that I got during the interval where Stevie is like asleep at the side of the stage, he made like most of the set. He added things to make it his own, which I think is so fun. I'm not sure about the understudy though, because I reckon that it still was just Stevie's set, but I digress. It's cool. So as I said, he is a failed comedian. Now, he does a lot of stand-up at the start of the show to the audience, and I think that most of that is
what I like to call scripted improv. And that's where, like, he has a vague script of, like, what he needs to do, where he needs to go, what he needs to talk about. But he improvises it. Stevie even said in a live before the show even made its tour debut that he did a lot of improv in the show. And I think the beginning is, like, the main point of improv that he does, because he is alone on stage. He's not talking to anyone, so he can kind of talk how he wants and be his own person. But yes, I just remember Stevie saying that every show is going to be like a little bit different, so that's why I think a lot of it, or most of it at least, is improv. Now, I said this in the interval, Stevie's acting is very raw, it's very real, and that just makes it even more relatable to the people watching it. He is an exceptional actor in this, and like, I know he was incredible in the Book of Mormon, but his character was a bit more set in stone for Book of Mormon, and he was also a supporting role. To see him doing like phenomenal acting in the main role in this huge show now in the UK, like, that is insane, and I am so proud of him. I can't stress that enough. Part of that very real acting, I think, is Stevie just being Stevie. His acting and his stand-up bits overall, it really reminds me of his TikTok skits that he does. I am convinced that his TikTok skits were like part of his audition, or at least something that the casting directors looked at when they were auditioning people, because there is no way that they did not cast him somewhat based on those skits, because it has a very similar vibe overall, which leads me back to the point of Stevie just being Stevie. I think the role of Kevin, whoever plays it, the role is very customizable to you, because most of it's improv, you can sort of be yourself, and obviously, since we have all been through this pandemic, we can add our own feelings and our own thoughts on it, which I just think is really lovely, especially with the message that the show conveys, which is basically about loving yourself and accepting yourself before letting anyone love you, basically, essentially. That's what the plot is. Also, so I know this isn't related to the plot, like, at all, but Stevie doing drag for an entire Dolly Parton song is not something I thought I needed in my life, but my god, I did. Now, Trisha Paolucio, I think I might be pronouncing her surname a little bit wrong there, but she plays Dolly Parton. Now, me personally, I know Dolly's music, but not really Dolly as a person, you know? Whereas I feel like a lot of her, like, actual fans are very, very intimate with her in the way that they do follow everything she does, from Dollywood to just being Dolly. Honestly, I know she's an icon, she is iconic, I do love her, like, a lot, and I feel like I can't, I'm not in a place to comment on Trisha's accuracy to being Dolly, but I think she was giving. Yes, I know, I'm using internet lingo. Get a grip. In my mind, what I gathered from the show and Trisha's interpretation is that Dolly is a southern beauty. She's very supportive and kind, but she's also very sassy, firm, and blunt when she needs to be. Can we just also talk about the fact that Dolly is in Kevin's head? She's not real. She is him. She's his inner voice presenting as Dolly Parton. And I think in his mind, that's so it's not him that's talking to himself. I think he makes up this thing that Dolly is speaking to him because he needs someone else, because he doesn't trust himself. And then he does realize in the end that Dolly is just in his head, and it is himself giving him these supportive life lessons and words and moments that just make the show so, so, so special. Their dynamic on stage was absolutely phenomenal. I may have seen a slight blooper between the two of them, but honestly, like, I love live theatre bloopers so, so much. I really hate it when people say, oh, it ruined the show. No, it didn't. It made it better. These are real people who are acting on stage and having the time of their lives. Like, they can have fun with it, and they definitely did. I can tell that they get along so, so well. And I'm really, really excited for the future of this show since it is going to London. Now, I am going to talk about my pet peeves with jukebox musicals for a tiny section of this video, just because I feel like with a show like this, where it's Dolly Parton and people are getting very drunk, there's a lot of issues with people singing for ages. Like, there was that whole, like, situation of someone getting, like, escorted out by the police at the bodyguard for singing. Now, it's obvious that I don't like singing at musicals. I respect any sort of musical theatre etiquette. I have told people off before for not engaging with a show by being on their phone or talking or being distracted or singing along. Now, I don't mind it too much when it's like kids and their parents are like, you know, gently telling them off and educating them within theatre etiquette, but when it's fully grown drunk women at a Dolly Parton show, I can't excuse it. And jukebox musicals have started to have to do this thing where they preface that you can sing at the end, and yet, even though they say that, people are still singing during the show and it loses everything. And it shits. And it just like spaces me out of the actual show so, so much, because all I can hear is a concert. It's not a concert, it's a musical. I'm calm. I'm calm and collected, can you tell? Now, there was an interview that Alison Hammond did, and I don't watch the news. I think it's on This Morning or something like that. I have no clue. All I know is that I really don't like her. Because she was like, oh, well, I paid to go see a musical. I can sing along because I paid. No, that's not how it works. Like, yes, if you buy the Mamma Mia DVD and you watch it at home, you can sing your fucking heart out, but not when you are with other people who have paid to watch the performers. That pisses me off that she was like very much advocating for singing in a theatre. Can I also stress that this was after the bodyguard situation? Can you see why I'm like, what the fuck? Theatre etiquette has just been lost, I swear to God. It's so fitting that this show is set during COVID, because that's kind of, you know, when theatre came back, that's when etiquette just kind of plummeted and never came back up. Since COVID, I have had so many more worse experiences with other patrons in the theatre for etiquette. Okay, I'm not going to end this review on a bad note. It is a really, really good show, and it has such an important message, and the fact that it is so real to so, so many people, and the fact that Stevie and Trisha are killing it, plus the supporting actors, like, oh my god, everyone in this production is so, so good. So would I recommend that you get down and see it? This is a new segment that I'm trying in my videos. Yes, I would 100% recommend this show. Just be warned from that little rant that I had that you may encounter some very drunk Dolly fans. Other than that, it's a really good show, and I am advocating for its long run because I just think that it is so, it's so relevant. So yes, other than my little complaint, the whole show is phenomenal, and I really recommend that you guys get down and see it if you haven't already. I will be trying to go again when it's in London, but for now, that cuts it for Here You Come Again, and let's move on to Back to the Future. Now, during this trip, I had a very spontaneous trip to the Adelphi Theatre to see Back to the Future, because I got rush tickets. Like, that was insane, by the way. Like, I am still not over that, but it did mean that I got to see a whole new cast. Well, not a whole new cast, but there were enough new faces that I was like, I gotta talk about these guys, especially because they're mostly main roles, like Marty, George, Biff, Goldie Wilson. Like, oh my gosh, I'm so excited. I love these guys so much. Stage Door was wonderful there, by the way. I saw Vasco, Orlando, CJ, Alex. I saw Corey English, who plays the Doc. Like, it was an insane night, okay? It was absolutely mental, but I cannot wait to talk about this new cast. So Vasco Amores plays Marty McFly, and this is actually his professional debut. Can I say that again, but slower? It's his professional debut. Vasco is definitely, pretty boy rock star, and he knows it, but not in like an egotistical way. Like, he's very suave and like he's very charming in his portrayal of Marcy. Now, one thing I'll say about Vasco in contrast to say Elliot or Ben, he is very, 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 very anxiety ridden that he is stuck in 1955, which anyone would be, but I felt like Ben especially had a very humorous panic which made the audience laugh, whereas I feel like Vasco, while he does make the audience laugh, he is like full of dread, to the brim, might I add. Like, he is terrified that he is stuck here. And honestly, that's a valid reaction. Like, Ben was a bit more like, oh man, and that's honestly kind of what Marty is like in the movie. Vasco's dynamic with Corey as the doc is incredible. Those two work so well together. Fun fact, I actually saw the first time that Corey made Vasco corpse. More stage bloopers, we actually love to see it. I love to see it, and honestly, Back to the Future, I have found, is very welcoming to onstage bloopers and corpses, but I feel like that is not onstage corpses. I mean that in the theatre sense, obviously. But I feel like every time I've been to Back to the Future, it is the same scene that Corey seems to always find the funniest. And every single time, without fail, there has been a break of character moment, but this was like the best version of that. The fire extinguisher stopped working. If you know what I'm talking about, you know. But it was absolutely hysterical, like everyone was going nuts. And honestly, Corey's improv is so, so good, and just Vasco had a moment, I feel, and I feel this. I'm not saying, oh, this is what he felt like. I feel this in the moment that he was very like, I'm here and I'm playing Marty and I've got all these people behind me. And for a professional debut, even though he's been doing it for like 2 months, that's gotta feel amazing. The fact that Vasco's acting as Marty is a little bit more serious than perhaps Ben or Elliot is what makes it funny. And also, by the way, the rock star vibe, like, oh my god, she has killer vocals. I mean, you saw that from the curtain call. This guy can sing and sound like a rock star. Vasco, I love you and you are so, so sweet. And I feel like I almost made him cry by like how much I was praising him at stage door, but oh my gosh, we've got a great new Marty in the West End, folks. Now, Orlando Gibbs is our new George McFly, the bumbling idiot turned author and very, 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 very author, might I add. But he was played by Orlando Gibbs. And the first thing that I noticed about him, because obviously the first time we see George, he is at home and he is being bullied to shit by Biff. And then his family join him and it's a really nice moment. Hello, Is Anybody Home is like one of my favorite songs ever. But the first thing I noticed about him is that he makes George's iconic laugh.
Oh, 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 no.
That one. His complete own thing. Now, I'm not saying copying the movie source is bad. Essentially, since it is an adaptation of the movie, copying is okay, especially when it's something as iconic as that. But I feel like it's really refreshing to see an actor take a character and just completely, like, not completely change it, but like make it into what he can do as an actor. Now, George in 1955 is obviously very awkward. He keeps to himself. His version of My Myopia was so, so good. Again, like, that's one of my favorite songs. Just because I love George McFly, okay? He's amazing and he's... George McFly has my heart, but like, oh my gosh, he was incredible. And I feel like his rejection anxiety is so much more real, like kind of what I said about Vasco's anxiety about being stuck in the 50s. I feel like Orlando is like very, 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 very panicky and very, very like, no, I can't let anyone else see this because they will make fun of me. It's not like it's not played off as a joke, you know what I mean? It's a very, very real fear that he has about anyone reading his science fiction stories. But within that anxiety, you can really see that George is passionate about what he does. He really wants to make something of himself, but he just doesn't know how to go about it. One thing, also, he loves Lorraine for her, and you can see that from the very, very beginning. I feel like in the movie, and I also feel like this is more a product of its time, but I feel like George was only really interested in Lorraine because she was pretty and she was the popular girl in school. I feel like in the musical it does this amazing thing where they change this dynamic and they add to it and they make it more true love. You know, George loves Lorraine for being Lorraine, you know, not just because she is pretty or the most popular girl and Biff wants her. And like, you know, I feel like their relationship is so much more thought out in the musical. But Orlando is a very, very talented guy. He's also absolutely lovely. I do love him as George McFly. Moving on to CJ Borgia as Mayor Goldie Wilson, or just Goldie Wilson in the 50s. This is something I do want to talk about. He has pretty much, I feel like, okay, if we're looking at the soundtrack on like Spotify, the songs that people go to and are most attracted to are maybe the opening, It's Only a Matter of Time, It Works, 21st Century, Future Boy. But I feel like Gotta Start Somewhere is so, so hyped up by the audience, and I love that for him. It's kind of similar to what I said about Sit Down, You're Rockin' the Boat from Guys and Dolls. He's very sassy, but he's also very kind and supportive of George especially. And I just gotta talk about something real quick. So, October in the UK is Black History Month, and I am so, so upset that I am not getting this out during October. But Back to the Future made a lovely post, which CJ got to talk a little bit about Goldie Wilson in and what he represents in the show as a black man in the 1950s in America. Now, obviously, I will let you go watch the Instagram reel for yourself, but in short terms, CJ mentions that Goldie is the symbol of change in the show, change and evolution, and progress, you know, like, progress is his middle name, like, that's his whole thing. And in this reel, it is very clear to me that CJ knows the importance of the role and that he is very, very grateful to get to play this role on stage almost every day of the week. He owns that stage with so much power and confidence, even though he doesn't have that much time to own it. He absolutely does, and I love him for it. I love CJ, and I cannot wait to see more of him in this show. Alex Ronicles as Biff Tannen, the big bully. Alex is very loud and in charge, you know. He's very stupid, funny, but he's also proud. Like, he wears this school on his back. He is very like, I own the space, I own the stage, and everyone has to move around me. And I feel like that's something that the actors know to do. You know, they know to let Alex just run the space when he is on stage, which I love. Because it just drills it right into his thick skull, the power that he thinks he has, but he doesn't really have. You know, everyone's more terrified of him. You know, they don't love him, they are scared of him. He does think he's the best for Lorraine, and that's what makes him an awful character and an awful person all around. Now, I like Biff in the alternate future, when George has punched him in the car and him and Lorraine have walked off happily ever after. I like the future Biff, especially the way Alex does it. I feel like he's very much kind. He's a kind man, he's a changed man, and I like that about him. I feel like the others just make him a slow idiot that George can boss around. Like, no, I feel like Alex makes him a changed man, a sweet man, but he's still silly, he's still bumbling, you know. He's not a coward to George, which again, I feel like a lot of the others do because George becomes this very bossy figure. But instead of being this kind of entirely new character, he plays a character that learned a fucking lesson. And I enjoy the new take on future Biff being a good guy. Maybe not an entirely good guy if they go into the Back to the Future 2 territory, but for now, I do really like how Alex portrays future Biff. And also, in real life, Alex is a total sweetheart. Like, I absolutely love him. The contrast of, like, seeing an actor who plays such an awful role be, like, so lovely is so... It's so nice. It's so, so nice. But yes, those are my thoughts on the new Back to the Future cast. obviously the main people that have joined the cast recently. Obviously everyone in the ensemble is absolutely amazing. Like, I cannot stress how much I love this show. And I've fallen into a bit of an obsession with the movie trilogy, not gonna lie. But that's not what we're talking about. We're talking about the musical, and as it stands right now, it is so, so good. And these new guys are amazing. So get yourself down to the Adelphi ASAP. But I think that's gonna cut it for this video, finally. This video is so long, it's so long, but I think we've finally got to the end of it and I've talked about everything I need to talk about for now. So, as I said, in the next video, I will be seeing the new cast of The Book of Mormon, and I am so, so excited for you to see this video because it was a really special trip for me. I feel like it's the biggest cast change I have ever seen yet. I'm just excited to see these guys again on Friday, I'm not gonna lie, but stay tuned for my next new video with the new cast, and I will see you then.